Visiting Vietnam for more than 10 years, legendary filmmaker Ken Burns and his partner, Lynn Novak, have worked to tell the comprehensive story of the Vietnam War. Everything from the politics to the protests, from the perspective of the people who lived through it. Watch.
What we do with civilization is that we learn to inhibit and rope in these aggressive tendencies, and we have to recognize them. I worry about a whole country that doesn't recognize it. Because you think of how many times we get ourselves in scrapes as a nation because we're always the good guys. Sometimes I think if we thought that we weren't always the good guys, we might actually get in less wars.
The first of the 10-part, 18-hour definitive documentary aired Sunday night on PBS. And joining me right now to take us behind the scenes in his first Business Network interview is filmmaker Ken Burns. Ken, congratulations.
Thank you so much. The response has been great to the first couple of episodes.
It's an incredible documentary. Why was this so important to you?
You know, I think we were finishing a film on World War II in 2007, and we just looked ahead in the roadmap of history and could see that the most important event after the Second World War for Americans is the Vietnam War, but it's still unfinished business for us. We haven't unpacked what happened, and when we talk about it, we tend to talk only about ourselves. So we went to Vietnam and we interviewed North Vietnamese soldiers and civilians and South Vietnamese soldiers and civilians and Viet Cong guerrillas to complement more than 50 Americans in this. So you get a really a 360 point, and we wanted to show this so that everybody felt that their own views and perspectives could be honored in this. And so, you know, a good deal of the divisions and the hyper-partisanship of today were born in Vietnam. If we could unpack and understand Vietnam, we may be able to pull out some of those fuel rods of disunion.
What did you learn most? I mean, you're right. This war tugs at our hearts, yeah. Continues to be debated, and this was an epic undertaking for you.
Yeah,
10 years.
10 years. You know, we learn every day was something new. I went in, I lived through it, I had a high draft number. I thought, gee, I know everything about Vietnam. I knew nothing about it. Some of the basic assumptions are turned upside down just by new scholarship, just by learning stuff, declassified materials. And what for us was most important was try to put together a team that the rest of the country would trust, particularly in these hyper-partisan things. We got this enlightened underwriter, Bank of America, who's been involved with us for 10 years, and they just said, go at it. I said, you know, this is very controversial. They said, do it. You know, better perspectives help us understand ourselves and help us be better connected to each other. And so that's been an amazing partnership, and they've signed up for the next 10 years. But we also went to every corner of the political spectrum. So we have support from the left, from the right, from the center, so that we could say that here we were just interested in facts, that Lynn Novick and I didn't have a political agenda, didn't have an axe to grind, and we're going to be umpires calling balls and strikes. And that's the way we've been.
That's what people want in this environment.
Right now, we need a particular this particular subject, which is so, people are in their hardened silos, if they're even talking about Vietnam, and they're actually certain. And, you know, Judge Learned Hand once said that liberty is never being too sure you're right. It's a good way to be a filmmaker, which you test and test again and retest. But it's also good for the public to realize that sometimes we find ourselves absolutely certain of our beliefs, and we find it hard to listen to the other. We try to create a space in which it's possible to listen to the other and hopefully get Vietnam behind us, to sort of say to the soldiers, not just thank you for your service, which is the end of a statement, like don't talk to me anymore, but welcome home, what can we do for you? And then you can hear in the North Vietnamese soldiers and the Viet Cong guerrillas, they sound a lot like our Marines and our Army guys. And our Marines and Army guys are going, God, I want to go back there. I want to talk to my former, you know, enemies, the guys who were down there in those ambushes and that intimate brawls, as the soldiers called it, that took place in that war.
So you learned a lot just along the way.
You know, and you know, courage, Maria, is not just in the battlefield. You know, sometimes it's a decision not to go. And what we tried to do is respect that and understand that, you know, by the end of this war, well more than a majority of Americans were opposed to it. And what was that about? And how do you understand the strengths and the mistakes and the weaknesses of the anti-war movement, along with what's going on from policy points of view, what's going on from a Gold Star mother? I mean, a Gold Star mother does not have to tell us about the worst moment of her life.
Right.
But by doing so, she gives us filmmakers a great gift, which we carry along for 10 years, and then it's a much more important gift to the American people. because lots of families struggle with grief. Lots of families struggle with loss, not just in war, but in other places. And she can help you get through tough times.
Particularly at a moment in time where there was all this anti-war sentiment out there. It was an incredible moment in time.
Well, you know, there's so many. We started this 10 years ago, and we felt like Vietnam always resonated in the present. But if you think about it, this is a story about mass demonstrations against the current administration, about a White House in disarray, obsessed with leaks, about big document drops of stolen classified material into the public sphere, about a president certain that the press is lying about him and making up stories, about asymmetrical warfare, and about accusations that a political campaign reached out during the time of a national election to a foreign country to influence that. So Mark Twain once said, history doesn't repeat itself, but it rhymes. When you watch the Vietnam War, there are lots of rhymes, and you have to understand, we finished this film before the Iowa caucuses. I mean, the editorial part of it, so we're not putting our thumb on the scale and say, neon sign, hey, isn't this a lot like today? But all good history says human nature is the same, and boy, is it a lot like today.
Interesting. So you do make some connections.
We don't make any of the connections ourselves. The intelligence of our viewer, regardless of their perspectives, are going to make some some connections about it. But that's the gift of history. Why would we study the past unless it helps us understand our present?
What surprised you most while you were doing this research?
You know, everything. I think the intimacy of battle is one of the things. This is a horrible, horrible war because most of the American engagements were sending out a patrol to be ambushed. You know, it's like Custer, you know, pulling guys out. The other thing is that Ho Chi Minh, who we just assume was the leader of the North, wasn't. He was sharing power with other hardliners on the Politburo who were designing the Tet Offensive and marginalizing him. He remained a figurehead to his people in the world. But, you know, that's like waking up and not knowing who your enemy is. And Johnson never even heard his name until 66, the guy who was actually running things, more or less, since 59. So almost everything you think you know, and believe me, I've been through the humiliation, is not true. And in the humbleness of reaching that, we could start to repack what actually happened and share with the country, regardless of where you're from or what you believe, the story of the Vietnam War, which, to just repeat, is the most important event in American history since the Second World War. And if we want to understand about now, we have to understand about then.
For sure. And I love your curiosity in your work. I mean, throughout your work. I'm going to tell people where to catch the Vietnam War tonight. Yeah. But first, what else are you working on after this, now that you've gotten this huge baby?
Well, you know, we're always juggling lots of different projects. We're doing a biography of Ernest Hemingway, a biography of Muhammad Ali. We're about two-thirds of the way through editing a massive series on the history of country music. And, you know, because Bank of America has signed up for the next decade, we're beginning to plot out things on the American Revolution, history of Winston Churchill, LBJ and civil rights, biographies of Benjamin Franklin. You know, if I were given 1,000 years to live, Maria, I would not run out of topics about our extraordinary country.
Well, you're a real business guy. You've set it all up in terms of the funding. Good
it's a little niche. And what it is in public broadcasting is we've got the support of foundations. We got the support of government granting agencies, of individuals from the Better Angels Society, a group of people across the political spectrum who support our work, and also from the corporation, sole corporate sponsor, Bank of America.
Good for you, Ken. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
It is an important film to watch. You can catch part three of the Vietnam War tonight on PBS, 8 p.m. Eastern. Check it out. Ken Burns, thanks for coming
in. Thank you, Maria.
Appreciate it very much. Come